Sergeant. That's Bourne. Relight the SF.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time.
Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You're too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take you to court. But at the end of the day, each and every member should go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back after being gone for about a month. It is March 7th, 2017, and I am coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights Tuesday through Thursday at 6 o'clock Pacific, 9 o'clock Eastern on the Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network, which now runs 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And you can listen to the live stream on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com and to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote self-ownership and the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, as well as exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we are always, of course, happy to hear from you. And you can reach us by phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or via Skype at Nonpartisan Liberty for All. That's Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Just send a user request or a whatever it's called request, and we will a contact request, and we will add you. Just send your name and what you want to talk about. So we've been gone for, geez, it's been over a month now. And part of the reason, I think, is just looking at the show and ways to improve it or kind of change the whole format. And really, during that time, looking at the amount of listeners, it's weird, you know, it will go up and down, and there were weeks where I had really good weeks, and then there were weeks where I didn't, and it just feels like sometimes it gets overwhelming. It's, you want to make a difference, and you want people to hear what you're saying and get the word out, but it's not as easy as you think it might be. Of course, there's other things that I can do to promote the show, and I've talked about doing YouTube videos and things like that, and I've kind of been discouraged, I guess, as far as getting into that, which I really want to start doing, and I think that will help, as well as putting more time into the show. That was another thing where between, and I've talked about this before, of course, between work and everything else, You know, it's hard to do a show 3 days a week, and I really didn't want to cut down to, say, 1 day a week, which a lot of shows do, and there's nothing wrong with that. And, you know, maybe that's something I should do. Maybe 3 days a week is too long. I know there's some shows that do an hour for 1 day a week. And I feel like even now, when I had cut the show to 2 hours, and I always end up going over because it's not enough time to really get everything out there. Now, granted, I'll probably play maybe 20 minutes of clips that I have that have to do with the topic that I'm talking about, but that's not a lot. So, I mean, that's still an hour and 40 minutes minimum if I actually do the 2 hours. And as I said, a lot of times I don't, I go over. So hopefully I'll get back to the routine where it's every Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and I need to change up as we run 24/7 the playlist of prior shows. The one thing I don't want to do is, since I got my new mic, although I have a whole over a year of shows, I don't want to go back to the shows that don't sound as well. So I'm keeping it limited that way, but at the same time, I still have a number of shows that I can play, along with the 30 plus shows of the Illumination Hour that Ellen had done. And because I haven't been doing my show and I haven't really been really thinking a lot about it, although that was my intent, it didn't end up that way. And I still need to talk to Ellen as far as when and if she's going to come back. What I got from her was that she would, but I totally understand if she does not, because, like I said, I mean, even, you know, doing a show, because there was a couple times where, or a couple weeks where I only did one show. And even that, I mean, it's not an easy thing when you have other responsibilities. So I totally respect the people that get out there and do these shows. And a lot of them, I don't want to say a lot, but at least on YouTube, I've talked about this before, you have these 5 and 10 minute clips, or people that do, you know, between 5 and 10 minute clips. And I think that's really for this current generation, I guess, that has a short attention span. You know, that's what they want to see. But the numbers on these of people that just can't come out of nowhere and get all of these views is crazy. And it's not like, I mean, some of them are pretty good, and some of them are just, you know, average. I mean, all of them that I think are getting those numbers are definitely good enough for YouTube. I don't know about having a show on regular TV or something like that. And I'm not saying that it's, you know, in some cases YouTube is better, to be honest, because when it comes to TV now, it's all controlled by the government. And if you're saying the wrong things, you'll get thrown off of it anyway. But I'm just saying from a professional standpoint, when you look at some of these videos, but definitely the radio shows that are on there are not, I've talked about this before, are not at a high quality. And I'm not looking at it comparing myself. I'm just looking at it as a listener, from a listener standpoint. And I've talked about this before, and I don't really see anything out there or anybody. I mean, there's some things, but there's such a small amount of people talking about the types of things I think that we talk about on the show and that have the same type of views. I've brought up before, the person that I probably have the most, my views are the closest to, at least based on what I've heard him talk about, is Larkin Rose. And I really haven't heard anybody else say, and I'll get into this tonight because we're going to talk about cops. I'm going to focus more on the smaller things compared to the murders and the beatings and things like that. But he's the only one that really I've heard, and there's a couple other people, so I don't want to take anything away from them. And then, you know, people probably don't even know who the fuck I am neither, so they wouldn't mention me in saying this neither. But that comes out and says, you have the right to defend yourself against the police. And the situations I'm going to talk about tonight, I mean, the majority of them, I believe you have the right to defend yourself against the police. Now, saying you have the right to do that and advising people to do that is a totally different thing, or actually doing it, because most likely you're going to get killed or you're going to be in jail for a long time. However, at the same time, people are scared to even say something like that. And most people will say, well, I don't think that that is right, that you have the right to defend yourself against a cop or whatever. And excuse the pun, but it's a cop out with a lot of people. I don't think they believe that. And I'm talking about more anarchists or voluntarists or libertarians. I'm not talking about your average person, because your average person does believe that. They believe, oh my God, that somebody would actually defend themselves against a cop. And what is really the difference? And you look at, what is the difference between a cop and somebody else in another fucking job? All it is it's their job that they applied for, that they happen to get, that the government says you have this power. And really, to sit there and have that attitude like, oh my God, you know, you would defend yourself against a cop, or you think you have the right to defend yourself against a cop. Like, the attitude that the average person takes on that is just crazy. Like, cops are some kind of gods or something like that. Now, a lot of them believe that they are, and that's partially why. I mean, a cop is just a fucking person like everybody else with a job, and their job is to, you know, take orders that they claim to not even be responsible for. And as you hear in the intro to the show, it's, you know, we don't make the laws, we just enforce them. Even though, as I mentioned before, they're the first ones to lobby for drug laws and things like that. So they're so full of shit, because if you legalized all drugs or just made drugs like anything else, you take away like 90% of their jobs right away. So they realize that, you know, drugs being illegal is a huge part of their quote unquote business. And it also leads them to do other things that they really wouldn't have. I mean, contrary to what people think, murders are very murder, robbery, and I'm talking like, you know, armed robbery, not somebody breaking into somebody's house when they're not home, because usually they're not going to recover that, nor do they seem to care. I've heard a lot of stories about break-ins when the person wasn't home and they really didn't give a fuck. The police, I mean, not the people who got broken into, because I'm sure they would give a fuck, as would I. But, I mean, they wouldn't really have much to do. If you legalize drugs. And don't think that's not a factor in why drugs aren't legal. I mean, it's like, it's so fucked up, man. It's like they want drugs to be there, but they want them to be illegal. So they, being the government, you know, let the CIA bring drugs in and shit like that. So they can still have the people fucked up off of drugs. They can still have the law enforcement budgets, the DEA, and say that they want to, you know, rid the country of drugs and talk about the drug war and all this bullshit. But they still have, it's like creating a war. They create their own war, and at the same time, they benefit on all sides of it because they want people to be fucked up. They want, you know, people to dumb themselves down, throw their lives away on drugs. Although there's plenty of people, and I talked about this on the show where I talked about Dr. Carl Hart and his findings, and I'm going to try to get him on the show. I want to read his book first. But he's a neuroscientist who's been studying drugs for 20 plus years. Not only that, he's done them. Now, I don't know what drugs he's done. I don't think he's done any hard drugs. I know he's smoked weed, as have most people have tried it. But I don't know what other drugs he's done. But he did talk about selling drugs and using drugs and then ending up in college and, you know, ending up getting his doctorate, and he's a professor at Cornell and did all this research on drugs and totally changed his view on them. And you can find that show in the archives. It's a pretty recent show, being that I haven't done one in a month. But he totally is, I look at him as, I'm trying to think of the word I'm looking for. I mean, I was going to say an innovator, but he's somebody who actually studied drugs and truthfully came out with, look, they're not as bad as you think they are. This drug is just like this prescription drug. The majority of people on drugs are normal people like everybody else. They go to work every day. They have families. This is just ridiculous. So now I might not agree with him on everything, but I mean the work he's done and a lot of these grants, and this is something that he had mentioned, you know, 90% of these grants are from pharmaceutical companies or basically agencies that want you to come back with the conclusion that, oh, this is bad for you. So they're not, they already know that they're supposed to come back with this. And then you think about something like that, and it makes me think of something like climate change, for example, where, oh, all the evidence shows this, well, but when you have somebody who really looks at it objectively, who even went in with the attitude of, oh, you know, crack is destroying my neighborhood, and went in, though, looking just at the science and did years and years of research and comes to the conclusions he comes to and has the balls to come out and actually say, look, this is bullshit. Now, he doesn't come out and say, look, you know, go do heroin. It's good for you. And, and he's not saying that, but or crystal meth or anything like that. But on the other side, he's saying, look, you're not going to do a drug once and get addicted to it. You're not going to even do a drug twice and all of a sudden be addicted to it. You can't stop. And, you know, all of this fucking propaganda that they put out there, it's just not the case. And something like crystal meth is the same thing as Adderall, essentially. He went through, you know, the molecules and whatever. And crack is the exact same thing as cocaine. The only difference is, and someone was trying to tell me it's not, but he explained it, is the hydrochloride molecule is taken out when you make crack. And the only difference is you can't smoke cocaine. So all it does is it gives you the ability to smoke it and get a quicker high. Now, if you inject cocaine, you'll get the exact same high. And maybe I shouldn't be saying this if people go do it. But you'll get the exact same high as if you smoke crack. Because they're just removing a molecule that makes it smokable is really all they're doing. And, you know, the same thing, like I said, with Adderall, which can be a good thing for certain people that need it. Just like painkillers, which are opiates, which are similar to heroin, I guess in some ways. I don't know. I've never done heroin. But he didn't come out and actually say the chemical compounds that heroin and painkillers are the same. But they're derived from the same plant and from... they're all opioids. But the point being, the only difference is that you don't know what you're getting, and which is another reason why drugs should be legal, because you don't know what you're getting. So the difference could be, yes, if it follows the chemical compounds that it should, then it's the same as this. But if they throw some other shit in there, then it's not, and then you're getting shit and it might fuck you up. Like they did studies on crystal meth and brain damage, and there's no evidence that crystal meth even causes brain damage. So the point being, now again, you could have some people that are putting other shit in it. And that's where you have so many fucking reasons why it should be as Daryl Perry of Free Talk Live and his show. I can't think of the name of his show off the top of my head right now. I'm sorry, Daryl. But it said cannabis should be like tomatoes. Well, so should every other drug. Actually, it shouldn't be like tomatoes. Every other drug should be like Tylenol. It should be sold like Tylenol. You know, every other pill and whatever. And plant should be sold like tomatoes. I mean, but even tomatoes are inspected by the FDA. I mean, I wouldn't even have a problem with that if it went through the same, although I don't believe in any of that shit and having government and whatnot, but even if it went through the same process that food goes through. But as far as going to buy it and it being legal, you should just be able to walk into a store, buy a fucking bottle of painkillers, buy a bottle of cocaine. I don't know. I'd sell it in a bottle. I don't know. I guess a bottle of powder. And, you know, there's so many fucking things that it would affect. It's insane. In a positive way. You know, right there, you know what you're getting is one of them. But the other thing, of course, is cops. And the amount of, I talked about Las Vegas, the amount of drug arrests, not drug arrests, but the amount of arrests, you know, for violent crimes compared to everything else. And it was 25%, and this was over a 5-year period, and it averaged out to around 25% were for violent crimes, crimes listed on the FBI statistics. And 75% were for other crimes. I mean, it's ridiculous. And then you have this show, Cops. And I'm sure everybody has seen Cops at least once, or the majority of people. And I've seen it before, but I stopped watching it just because Cops make me sick. But I realized what I ended up doing recently was, as I mentioned at work, you know, I always need something to listen to. And you don't have to watch Cops to know, to hear, you know, what's going on. So they had episodes of Cops. So I'm like, okay, let me, you know, we'll just go through and go to the next one. So while I'm working, you know, I'm not catching everything, as I mentioned, you know, I'll catch bits and pieces and whatnot. So I was like, you know, I never really I've seen it before when I was younger, but I'm like, this is propaganda because, you know, when I seen it, I've only seen like a couple scenes here and there because they control it. And of course, they're going to show the police in a good light. And then I'm watching it and they're doing that in certain places, but cops can't stop. I mean, they cannot even stop themselves from being assholes, even on a show that they control. I mean, if they edited out everything, there'd be no fucking show if they edited out those parts. So even though other people might be like, yeah, that's a bad guy and whatever, because most of the shit is fucking drugs, and we'll get into that. But they come off like assholes. You can see how they violate people's rights. The thing they do on the show that they don't do in reality, and they don't do this, and I've had experience with cops. I know people who have had experience with cops. After they arrest people and shit dies down, they realize, oh, fuck, we're on a television show. That's, you know, a national show. We got to show, hey, we're nice. And so they pull that shit where they're nice to the people. They're really not, though, because for the average person, they're going to think, oh, they're being nice. You know, they're talking to him after. They're letting him have a cigarette. Even the guy ran away from them and whatever, and they're still being nice to him after. And some of them can't control themselves, the cops. They won't be nice to him. But a lot of them will, because they realize after they calm down, like, oh, shit, I'm on, you know, I got to remember that we're on a show here, even though they're going to edit it. And I'm sure cops, the police departments have a certain amount of control, but they want to show them in a good light at the same time. So they'll be nice to them after, at least most of the time. They'll try to act like they're nice after the arrest happens, and they'll talk to them and. But at the same time, they're being nice to them because they're trying to get more information as well. So they're tricking them at the same time while they're trying to show the ignorant public that they're nice. So, and they cut out, of course, the majority of people that don't talk to them. They, of course, show all the people that are idiots that talk to them. I'm sitting there like, you're a fucking idiot. Shut up. I mean, half the people that get caught, and they're getting caught for drugs. I started even recording it and watching it on TV at home. And there's a way to, you know, get every episode of Cops on the internet. It goes back to like 89. And, you know, of course, it's all the same shit, no matter what year you're looking at. But it's all car stops and trying to get a person to fuck up so you can search their car, so you can find, most of the time, drugs, sometimes guns. It's all guns and drugs. Guns and drugs, illegal. What are the police going to do? Seriously, I mean, 90%. I mean, you do have stolen cars, which, I mean, yeah, I consider that a crime, of course. You're stealing somebody's fucking property. But depending on, you know, the circumstances, I mean, sometimes it's somebody took a car from their girlfriend or boyfriend and they, you know, they didn't have permission, reported stolen, whatever. But some people are actually, you know, they stole a car. They try to show those, of course. And remember, everything is being edited. But my whole point is that even on a show that you have total control over, and keep in mind that editing makes a show. if you watch a reality show, and I guess Cops is a reality show, it's a different kind of reality show, but I can't stand reality shows because it's a bunch of people. It makes stars out of people with no talent. That it's just they're just stupid. And reality shows are all in the editing because they just film people, you know, 24 hours a day and then fit it into an hour. Now, you think about that with the show Cops, and in the Cops episodes are only a half hour. And then they're showing, you know, they ride with the cops, you know, all day or for a week or, you know, a significant amount of time to fit into a half hour show that is not even the same cops. So you think about that, that they don't have even stuff to fill the time that's entertaining enough to fill a whole fucking show with one cop or a cop and his partner, because it's just not, it wouldn't be entertaining enough, one. And then all the stuff that is bullshit where they violate people's rights or they hit somebody or they the person's innocent. And they search their car because they have the dog hit on it, or the person just won't talk to them and they're unable to do anything. I mean, all of these things, they're not going to show. Because, again, they're trying to show the cops in the best light possible. But, again, my point is, even in the best light possible, where they have, you know, maybe weeks of footage or at least a day of footage, so you're taking, at minimum, you're taking a day of footage. Maybe you're not even using it and getting and condensing it into about 5 minutes. Because, again, in a half-hour show, and it's not even a half-hour, it's about 20 minutes because you have commercials, you're showing one incident of a cop somewhere. And think about that. So you're trying to find, like, their best, the time you spent with them, not only their most entertaining, I think it's partially entertaining, but I think it's about propaganda and it's about them okaying it and having them look in the best light possible. And even in that, they still look like fucking assholes. And you can still see that all they're doing, about 90% are what they're doing. I mean, watch, you know, 10 episodes of Cops, or, you know, watch take a sample size of Cops, the show, and you'll see that the majority is drugs. And occasionally you get stolen cars. And they love that. They'll put the stolen cars in there. And you get people running. That's that's always exciting. So the majority of incidences, right, are, this happens a lot, riding a bike at night without a light. And a lot of times the person will run. And riding on, because they might have a warrant. Riding on the sidewalk, riding your bike on the sidewalk, evading, which may be a result of riding your bike on the sidewalk or riding without a light. The obstruction, which of course is what I got charged with, which they can pretty much charge you with that for anything. If they talk to you, they can charge you with fucking obstruction. I mean, obstruction, a lot of these crimes, obstruction, resisting arrest. I mean, there are people that get arrested for resisting arrest, and that's their only charge. How can you resist arrest from resisting arrest? Like, you're not being arrested for, you have to, like, what are you resisting arrest from if there's not another crime there? And then In those, of course, you know, drugs, drug possession, and one was, I mean, not one, but a couple times walking in the street, drug paraphernalia, license plate light, you know, they'll pull somebody over, and domestic violence stuff. And even that, I mean, it's ridiculous. And they're like, depending on the state, and most states do this now, they have to arrest somebody. Why do you think they put that in? Because then they get an arrest and somebody is in the system and they have to pay money. And it's just a whole fucking, you know, cops are there for, in my opinion, a few reasons, and none of them have to do with protecting anybody or keeping them safe. And it's funny they say that on the show. Oh, that's what we're here for, and, you know, I'm here to keep people safe. And, you know, I wonder how many times, if you've watched Cops, a lot of times they'll show a cop in a car, and he's going out, and he'll talk about why he became a cop or, you know, what he does and why he does it. Oh, my parents were cops and I want to help people. And you're not helping anybody. And these are just idiots. I mean, they even say sometimes, like, you know, when it's slow and we don't have much to do, you know, we'll try to go after and just find criminals or just, you know, go to places and see. They actually went to a place in Las Vegas, and I know where it is. I'm not going to say. It's like apartment complexes. And there were two people sitting in their cars doing nothing. And I guess one of the guys sold the other guy weed or something. But they didn't see that. All they saw was two people sitting in their cars. And they just go up to the car and open the door. And they're doing this shit. That one was based on the fact that the officer, he didn't have shit to do. It was like, I don't have shit to do. I'll go harass people. The whole purpose of cops is to fill the jails, what they would call generate revenue, basically rob you, extort money from you, and to teach discipline and scare people. Quote unquote, keep people in line. So, if you ask, do the cops do their job? Well, of course they do their job, because that's what their job is. Do they protect people, keep people safe, and the things that people would like from cops? No, they don't. You know, and it pisses me off. I was watching, because I think it's a really good movie, because I'm an Al Pacino fan. If anyone's seen the movie Sea of Love. If you haven't, you should get it. It's an old movie. It's from 89. It's not old, but to some people that would be pretty old. But it's not like from the 50s or something. But he plays a cop, and then he talks about, there's this speech because he lies to a girl about being a cop, but he doesn't tell her why he lied, because he's kind of investigating her, whatever. That's irrelevant. But he says, oh, when people get robbed and raped and this, you know, I'm the person they come to. I'm their daddy. Some fucking shit about being their daddy. I'm everybody's daddy. Something like that. Al Pacino, who's, you know, a great actor. But no, you're not, because you're coming there after the fact. So what are you doing? Maybe you catch the person who committed a crime, but you're not stopping any crimes. If cops stop a crime, it's just really like by accident most of the time, if they prevent a crime. And it's very rare. They get there after the fact. And they know that. And that's kind of the point. Because if crimes didn't take place, then the same thing, they wouldn't have a job. It's just like terrorism, man. It's the government wants to take away people's freedoms. They want to use something like terrorism to do it. They still use drugs to do it. and we'll get more into that. But, you know, if there's no terrorism, they can't use terrorism as a reason. And they even go so far because they're so fucking desperate, because essentially in the United States, there is no radical Islamic terrorism. There isn't. Say what the fuck you want. The Boston bombing, you know, that I follow closely. There's no way that that guy wasn't working for the CIA. It's just, it's ridiculous. I mean, just based on the, and I looked at a lot of stuff. I just didn't look at this. But just on the fact alone that both the CIA and FBI investigated him, and they didn't know that he went to Chechnya, and they said they didn't know because of a name fuck up. Like, his name was spelled differently. You're going to fucking tell me in what? This was 2013? In 2013, he might have went a year or two before. So, whatever. It was at least 2010. That, you have technology where you have whole grids in New York. You should see their fucking setup. And he was in Boston, and they have a whole big fucking setup with cameras and all this. The government can spy on people. They can tap into their computers, their phones, all this shit. And they must have had it for at least fucking 10 years, if not more. At least the start of it was way before that. But they had it when this happened. But you can't follow somebody because of a fucking, he spelled the way he spelled his name. You're not even talking about him trying to get a fake passport or something, that it was a spelling of a name. And people buy this shit. There were so many lies in that whole case that came to light. And this has to do with what cops do. They fucking lie. The chief of police, I've played this before. I have the clip of the chief of police of what was the city that they were in? I wanted to say Waltham. It's not Waltham. That's another city in Massachusetts. Watertown, of saying how, yeah, they had long guns and they had a couple handguns and whatever. They recovered one handgun. And the officer who got shot, not the one who got killed, who, that sounded like such bullshit too. Oh, they tried to take his gun. They didn't get his gun or anything, but they tried to take an officer's gun. So that sounds really smart. The guy is armed. They have one gun, and they're going to try to take his gun. Now, when you said they had a long gun and all of this shit, maybe it makes a little more sense. Anyway, they didn't admit it for like 2 weeks that in the shootout that they shot their own guy. They blamed it on them. So there, and that's just a little bit of it. There are so many fucking lies, and I've done so many shows on this shit, and I just don't get why the public and people in general cannot understand or cannot accept the fact that the government, obviously there's documented cases of it, so they've done it before, conducts false flags, that they conduct things like the Boston bombing or the World Trade Center bombing in order to push an agenda. And that might look, you know, so, or Sandy Hook, you know, oh, why would they do that? They'd actually, like, why wouldn't they? You got a lunatic. People don't understand how crazy these fucking people are. You know, at the time, Dick Cheney, who I actually believe was involved in it, I really do, as well as the CIA. You look at all the shit that the CIA has admitted to doing, but no, they wouldn't do that. No, of course not. Yeah, whatever. Fucking bullshit. So it's just really disheartening and sad that people will say all the shit about top politicians. They'll recognize how fucked up they are. They'll criticize them to the extent that they do. But, oh, no, they wouldn't do something like that, a false flag, even though they exploit the fuck out of things. And obviously you could see that with Sandy Hook and how Obama exploited that as much as he could to try to pass bills, excuse me, or to get bills passed. And he wasn't successful, but he exploited the shit out of it. And people don't understand, and I talked about this before I did a show on Sandy Hook, how important it is that people are disarmed at some point, that the U.S. government cannot fulfill their agenda, although they're not far from it, in my opinion, far from fulfilling their agenda of taking away freedom and just totally taking over, which is their ultimate agenda, which is the ultimate agenda, I believe, of all governments. That's the whole point of a government. But that they wouldn't do something like that. But they can't really explain why. I've never heard anybody... If you have to resort to calling people names or just dismissing something, then that's not an argument. I heard somebody recently just saying, oh, those people are crazy. The people that believe, you know, 9/11 was an inside job, that they're just crazy. Well, that's not an argument. What is the argument as to all of the information that supports it? It doesn't support anybody specific, but supports that the 9/11 commission was bullshit, that they can't explain Building 7, that, you know, all of these things, the Pentagon. Calling somebody crazy is not an argument. It's not, you know, and that's how people a lot of times will just respond to allegations, and they'll call people racist, they'll call people crazy, and then for some reason people just accept that. But you're talking about fucking sociopaths. I mean, you really are. These politicians are sick fucks. Not only that, you have an elite behind them that are really running things anyway. And I think some people in government are part of the elite. I think the majority of them are just puppets. But that's a whole nother story. And then, of course, you have the enforcers, like I like to call their dogs, the cops, because that's what they are. They just enforce whatever law, and then they claim they're not responsible. That they say, well, you know, we just enforce the laws. It's the politicians. So whatever they politicians say, and that's what a law is. This is something that too many people equate laws with morals and good and bad and those type of things, or that type of thinking. But it has nothing to do, laws have nothing to do with morality. They have nothing to do with good or bad. Now, you can point at a specific law and say, okay, this is like murder, and say this is bad. We all know what's bad, good or bad. Everything else is a gray area. There are certain things that you can't argue is good or bad. You know, if you murder somebody and it's not in self-defense, it's just cold blood, you just murder them and you don't have a reason except I killed them because I felt like it. That's bad, obviously. If you just walk up and hit somebody for no reason, that's bad. If you break into somebody's house, that's bad. Now, for no reason, oh, well, you don't have, if you broke into somebody's house because they stole shit from you and they wouldn't give it back, and the only way to get it back was to break into their house. That's a shade of gray. But in general, if you break into somebody's house and steal shit that's not yours, that's bad. Anything that has to do with a person or their personal property is bad. And then everything else is not necessarily good, but it's not bad, nor should it be illegal. But that's the whole thing here, is that laws are not based on what's good and what's bad. And a lot of that is, besides what I mentioned, everything else is subjective. And there shouldn't be any other laws, because laws should not be subjective, first of all. Nor does anybody have the right to tell somebody else what to do. Larkin Rose puts it the best when he talks about that. But so this is where, you know, in watching this show, Cops, 90% of the things that they're doing, as far as I'm concerned, are not crimes. And I believe you have the right to defend yourself. Now, I stress right, because I don't advise people to do it. I was going to say, nor do I do it, but I don't really have a reason to do it anyway. But as far as having the right, just because that there's a difference there too. Rights and laws are not the same thing neither. They're totally separate, because laws, in theory, should follow rights. But they don't. So again, the only things that should be illegal is the things that we all know. And that's why it used to be, you know, that if you don't know the law, that's not a valid excuse. But now it is a valid excuse, because there are so many fucking laws. And I go into this all the time too. You've had years and years of laws, 200 plus years of laws, depends from when you want to count from, but if you want to count from the Declaration of Independence, you've had 240 years of laws, well, 241, I guess 241 on July 4th, if you want to get technical, and I don't think they were passing laws after they issued the Declaration of Independence. But, and then you also had the Articles of Confederation kind of overthrow the government technically. And I say technically because they kind of followed what they were supposed to, but they kind of did it in a way that it was kind of shady, whatever. And then you had the Constitution. So either way, you know, it's at least 230 years of laws. And they're not going to stop. Every year there's more laws. It's like, and I've said this before, every new law, you should get rid of a fucking law. You even have cops. I mean, they have computers now. So like one of the times I was arrested, and 3 days later I got a note from the district attorney's office saying they weren't going to file charges because it was a bullshit arrest. And the cops, I've talked about this before, the cops had even told my fiance that they just didn't like my demeanor. And you know what, to be honest, my demeanor wasn't even that bad. Like, I've given cops attitude before, and I really didn't give them an attitude. I was just kind of like, you know, I was caught off guard doing nothing, minding my own fucking business. And you know, I don't know, you expect me to be like, hey, officer, how you doing? You know, I was just like, I didn't give him an attitude, but I wasn't fucking Mr. Friendly, nor should I have to be, nor do I have any obligation to be. So anyway, That was ridiculous. And I've said this before as well. Once you're arrested, you lose. No matter what, whether you're found not guilty. And I love how the cops, and they say it in the show, cops, they'll mention how, oh, you can, you know, take care of that in court or tell it to the judge or all that shit. They do say all that shit. And they make it like it's easy. You know, it's just like, oh, yeah, you just go and you tell the judge. No, it is not easy. You have to go through the whole judicial process. You have to sit in jail until you get bailed out. So unless you're going to get compensated, which 99.9% of the people are not. Now, there's been judgments for people whose rights were violated. I should have fucking got compensation for that. For sitting in a jail. Not only did I sit I was at the jail and I sat there and I wasn't actually even in a cell, but for like 12 hours. And they made me wear a mask because I wouldn't take a shot. I'm like, really? So before I got here, I was fine to walk around. Now you want me to put on a surgical mask. But then when I leave, I can take it off. It was totally ridiculous. And it was all about you not following their orders. Because that's part of their job, too. It's to condition you to follow their orders. Because if they give you the worst experience possible, they'll try to make sure that you don't do the same thing again, especially if it's for something like, you know, obstruction, or where really your crime is you didn't kiss the cop's ass enough is really your crime. They should actually, you know, I mean, why fucking beat around the bush? Why not just have a crime that says you didn't kiss my ass and I'm a cop and that's what you're supposed to do? You're supposed to bow down and fucking kiss my feet. So, plus I was illegally searched and I had like a little pocket. It was a legal pocket knife and they tried to say it was illegal. They're like looking up on their computer. They didn't even know. They're like, fuck, what can we charge him with? It was just ridiculous. But anyway, the point being is, you know, these fucking guys are there for those reasons. They're not there to protect you or to keep you safe. And I think they even took to serve and protect off the cars, because they're not. Because if you think about it, being that they're paid by extortion money, we're all extorted and forced to pay cop salaries. And they should be doing shit like, you know, they should be driving drunk drivers home. Seriously. And I don't believe in DUI as a crime as well, because that's pre-crime, in all honesty. And if you're able to catch somebody drinking and driving and nothing has happened, why arrest them? Now, I know people will say, well, so they won't do it again, or to punish them. Well, there's nothing to punish them for as far as I'm concerned. So they mad at me, because you know what? Most people that want to punish them have drove drunk in their life before. It's just a fact. Most people in general, whether they've gotten, I've never gotten a DUI or anything, but that doesn't mean that I've never driven when I shouldn't have. I haven't drank in like 2.5 years now or something like that. I don't know. It's been a long time, but so obviously it's not something I worry about at this point. And I, you know, when I was younger, maybe, I did some things I shouldn't have done. But if you look at, And I think people are conditioned as to how cops should be as well. But if cops are really there to serve and protect people, and you think about that, there's a customer service aspect that they don't give a fuck about for a variety of reasons. But one reason, among others, is they have a monopoly, because you cannot go and hire other protection services. And whether you need them or not, which I'm sorry, I don't need the fucking police. Because, number one, what are they going to do? Get there after a crime has happened? So if my house got broken into while I'm not home and they're going to recover my shit, I seriously doubt it. If my house gets broken into when I am home, I can take care of that. And I can take care of my own protection and my family's protection. And I'd rather not pay for them, nor have them, you know, have anything to do with them. Just leave me alone, basically. You know, if I don't support people that have, you know, there's been, and first of all, just so people know, and I should have looked up the statistics for last year, but being a cop is like not even in the top 15, or it's right around 15 most dangerous jobs. It's a bunch of bullshit. Now, maybe if you work in like a really, really bad neighborhood, but even then, because there are not, believe it or not, in a country this big, and I always have to bring this up because nobody puts anything in perspective, there are not a lot of murders based on the percentage of population. There's just not. There's not a lot of people that are committing things I would call crimes. And that would be anything where you harm another person or their property. You know, like I said, murder, assault, breaking into somebody's house, stealing their car, whatever. Stealing their property. Everything else is just bullshit. But going back to, you know, the serving and protecting thing and the money that people pay. And in Las Vegas, it's public information. I mean, you have patrolmen making $80,000 a year. A lot of these guys with overtime and everything. And then plus benefits. And then that puts them at like, you know, and I don't know if benefits cover, it's probably pension and shit like that. And then they can retire after 20 years. And it's like, I'm not going to say the job is easy just from a standpoint of, you know, a lot of people fucking hate you, first of all, because you're just blindly enforcing laws that and playing like you're not responsible for your actions. Like that, well, I didn't write the law, I just enforce it. Well, you don't have to enforce any law, actually. If you think something is wrong, you don't have to enforce it. And also, you don't have to be a cop. So, being that they're kidnapping people, they really don't deserve any salary. But anyway, they make pretty good money. And they should be doing things that actually do serve and protect people. And I stress to serve and have good customer service and whatever. But they have a monopoly on force, and you can't hire anybody else. And you can't hire people to protect you from the cops. That's why I'm more afraid of the cops than the terrorists. One, because there's fucking no terrorist anyway, really, because besides, you know, if you want to count two shootings as terrorists, okay, fine, as far as I'm concerned. The other, and I think in one of them, the cop shot a bunch of people, or there was another person there, and they somehow got away. But I think the cops shot a bunch of people. That whole thing in Orlando is very strange, how they handled that. So I don't know. The other one, I do believe that most likely what they said happened, but who the fuck knows? We have, and I know I'm kind of jumping all over the place, but we have an information problem, because who controls the information? Well, the police and the government. So how are you going to get information about the people that control it? You're not. I mean, you have to have somebody who, independent witnesses that are willing to actually tell you the truth. If it's something the government doesn't want you to know, you may be threatened. So it's just crazy to even get, you know, news, to get accurate news in the first place anyway. But I was going to say, as far as cops go, and I don't think they should exist, period. But I do not, and I've said this before, support people that have just randomly killed cops. I mean, that's just, I don't support anybody randomly killing anybody. It's just wrong. So to me, it's not really even because they're cops. It's more just people just randomly killing people is just, now I can understand their rationale, assuming it is what some people, I'm trying to even think of how to phrase this, like, assuming the rationale is that they're frustrated, they feel like there's no other actions that they can take, that they're stuck in this system, and there's, you know, I can understand it to a point. I would definitely advise against it, and I don't believe that's the way to go in for anything to make a difference or to try to change things, to just randomly kill people. It's wrong. But at the same time, I don't look at those people the same way other people do. Now, in self-defense circumstances, I think that they definitely have the right, and I don't have an issue with that. The problem is that they're going to lie, and they're going to take the cop's word over the person that was defending themselves. And most of those people, there's been incidents where cops have, you know, no-knock warrants have come into houses and people have shot them. And there's a couple people that have gotten off, and there's people that haven't, and it depends on the state. And I'd have to go and research the specifics. I just remember hearing about a few in the media, and more in independent media. But depending on the state and the circumstances, some people actually got off or weren't charged, or eventually the charges were dropped, and there's people who went to jail. Now, when it comes to violating your rights, I believe the same thing. Now, that doesn't mean I'm going to go and do it, because they're going to kill me. But that's, and I'll be careful, I guess, with my words here. And no, I won't. I mean, I would defend myself if I was in that situation, if I knew that they weren't going to kill me. But being that I know, you know, they're going to fucking shoot me up with a bunch of bullets, or I'm going to go to jail for defending myself or defending my rights, that would be the only thing that would stop me, because, you know, you ruin your life over whatever it might be, you know, a traffic stop. And it's, I think it's justifiable. And I think people should realize that. And I wish more people did realize that it's justifiable. Now, it's unfortunate if it came to that. I've always talked about the best case situation if a cop was violating your rights would be like what happened at the Bundy Ranch and a standoff. And nobody got hurt, but no one's rights got violated. Like if a cop was gonna violate your rights and you defended yourself, or were in the process of defending yourself and it was a standoff and nobody got hurt. Because at the same time, I don't want to see anybody get hurt. But you have to look at how far cops are going for ridiculous things. And people can just keep having their rights violated and being oppressed by the police. And this is not, I'm not talking about the people that are getting killed. I mean, that's a whole nother issue. I'm talking about the people that are being dragged out of their cars, are being arrested for obstruction, are being illegally searched, you know, all these things that their rights are being violated. And as I had said earlier, there's the difference between rights and laws. So they may say, well, we're in our legal right within the law, but you're not in your, you don't have the right to do what you're doing just because the government said, oh, well, we passed a law, so you have the right. The government has no authority to tell people what they can possess, what they can, because it really, it's all over. If you really want to break it down, as I mentioned earlier, I mean, the majority of this is drugs. It is so fucking ridiculous that people are going to jail. People are getting beaten, their rights violated, and sometimes even killed over drugs. And I'm not talking about drug dealers getting killed. That's a whole nother issue that would go away. You wouldn't have violence. Just like I always say, you know, and I probably took this from somebody else, you don't have Bud Light and Miller Light fucking shooting it up in the fucking, you know, middle of the street. So just because it's a law doesn't mean they have the right. And as far as I'm concerned, and I don't give a fuck, I'll say this on air, that people have the right to possess drugs. They have the right to put what they want in their body. And people have been so fucking brainwashed and conditioned, not only to how dangerous drugs are, because they're not as dangerous as people think they are, but that they have some kind of right to tell people what to put in their body just because they live in society with them. Like fucking Sean Hannity, I remember him saying, well, what if somebody gets high and then breaks in my house or somebody's house? Well, then they committed a crime. You arrest them for breaking into a person's house. What does that have to do with it? You actually have a better, more people now that would do something like that because they can't afford drugs, because the government has the street value so high because it's illegal. If it was legal, it'd be a lot more affordable. You wouldn't have people robbing people, among other things. But they want that because they want the street value high, because we know the CIA is funding a bunch of shit off all the drugs they sell. They had all of these, relationships with drug dealers and drug cartels, and a lot of it's declassified or documented. So it's really ridiculous in itself. The hypocrisy that you have the government bringing in drugs, but then you're putting, you know, some poor fucking drug user, you know, a lot of times from a poor neighborhood in jail. And having him pay whatever little money he has to fucking, you know, get out of jail and pay whatever stupid fines. But you're bringing in, you know, billions of dollars worth of drugs in the first place. That's one reason, you know, you can't win the drug war if the side that is, and it's not a, the fact that they call it a war and it's not winnable anyway, because people will always find something to get high. That's why when I was in high school, people would huff fucking rubber cement, okay? They'll find some fucking way to get high, and you can't ban everything. But you at the same time, even if it was a quote-unquote winnable war, if the side that's fighting the war is also aiding the enemy, essentially, how can you win the war? Just like the war, quote-unquote war on terror, same thing. Hey, if you're creating a fucking terrorist organization like ISIS and you're giving them weapons and then you're fighting them, how do you expect to, you know, you're aiding them at the same time? Because you have to create an enemy, because you have to have wars going, whether it's a war on drugs, a war on terror. And it's all about money, power, and taking away as much freedom from the American people as possible. Not the American people, people in general as possible. So on that note, we will take a break. And we'll be back after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. We're also on Facebook, Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And the Government Police is another Facebook page we have. And we're on Twitter, NP Liberty for All. All of that information you can find at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com, all our social media. You can also find original articles that I've written. I 6 or 7 on the drug war and why drugs should go back to how they were prior to 1914 when they passed their first drug law, the Harris Act. So go and check that out. And we'll be back right after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne.
We are back here in New York. Brian Williams here with you for this part of the day's coverage. We are joined by the 107th mayor of New York City, Rudolph Giuliani. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you for having me.
I should add, it'll be a special note to people watching us from New York. Condolences on your former deputy mayor, Peter Powers, who lost his battle yesterday with cancer.
Yes, thank you.
So I'm sorry you're dealing with that. On top of this, it seems to me, Mr. Mayor, we have two crises here, two tragedies, not mutually exclusive, as we were just saying, deaths that are linked by their senselessness. Mm-hmm. We've got Alton Sterling and Philando Castile, two deaths that when you look at them on videotape, no matter what you're feeling about law enforcement, if you're a normal person, it's sickening. And what do we do about that?
Okay, what we do about that is we investigate it, we prosecute it, and if they are guilty, and as anyone else, they're presumed innocent, right? If any of the police officers are guilty, we put them in jail. That's what we do about it. And that happens infrequently. it seems like it happens a lot because it becomes national news. But if you look at the number of murders of black men in America, that would make up less than 1% of the number of murders of black men in America. So the way we deal with it is to put it in proper perspective and be honest about it. What happened last night was the worst attack on law enforcement since September 11.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, just an added note there that it's something like 1,400 people a year are killed by police. Now, as I've said, and he just said, you know, putting it in perspective when it comes to the amount of people in the country. Now, that's not a lot of people, 1,400. But when your government, the people that are there to supposedly serve and protect you, are killing that many people, it doesn't matter about the percentage. There are certain things that percentage doesn't really matter. And that when you have your own government killing people, it doesn't, in my opinion, when it gets up, you know, to that high.
The people of Dallas should not feel guilty about it. It could have happened any place else in America. Police officers in this country feel they have a target on their back. And they felt that way for over a year now. Police officers Ramos and Lou, who were assassinated on purpose.
In New York City, yeah.
Yeah. And this man made his motives clear. He was killing them. I'm just reading from the police commissioner. He wanted to kill officers. And he...
If you work in law enforcement, I have a very important question for you, one which soon may be a matter of life or death. I'm sure some people become police officers just so they can boss other people around. But I'm going to assume here that you mean well, that you want to be one of the good guys. In which case, my question is this. Is there anything the politicians could enact into law that you wouldn't enforce? Is there any order that you would refuse to carry out? Or will you do absolutely anything your bosses tell you to? In the U.S., police have already obeyed orders to fine or arrest people for a wide variety of harmless activities, such as dancing at the Jefferson Memorial or having a vegetable garden in their front yard. Police have even gone so far as to execute violent paramilitary raids on food co-ops and organic farms. For decades, police have been carrying out armed home invasions, forced property confiscations, and other acts of violence against people who weren't hurting anyone, but who engaged in behaviors or habits which lawmakers have arbitrarily declared to be illegal. You may be comfortable in assuming that you'll never receive an order to do something truly immoral, but the fact is, with every order you receive, you have a choice between obeying without question or relying on your conscience. No doubt there were cops a few years ago who never expected to be ordered to disarm innocent people, to do door-to-door home searches without warrant or probable cause, or to detain and interrogate people for merely driving down a road. Yet police have since been ordered to do all of these things, and almost without exception, they obeyed. So it's not unreasonable to ask, is there any point at which you will draw a line and say, no, that I will not do? And if you won't draw such a line anywhere, if you will do absolutely anything your political masters tell you to, how are you any different from the enforcers of Soviet Russia, Red China, or Nazi Germany? You may be tempted to say, I don't make the law, I just enforce it. Or to argue that if some legislature, court, or some authority above you says it's okay, then it must be. But keep in mind that this is exactly what the thugs of every tyrannical regime in history said to justify their actions. And how do we remember those people now? As courageous, noble law enforcers? No. Unless you want posterity remembering you as a heartless, mindless pawn of oppression, then you'd better decide, and decide now, where you will draw that line. Unfortunately, there's little indication that most cops have any line at all. The incidents of police officers refusing to inflict injustice upon the people are extremely rare. Even when cops say they personally oppose certain laws, such as marijuana prohibition, nearly all of them continue to violently enforce these laws against nonviolent people. In other words, they recognize these laws as counterproductive and unjust, but they choose to enforce them anyway. For the most part, American cops seem completely incapable of disobeying immoral orders, and instead do what the enforcers of every other authoritarian empire have done, inflicting harm on innocent people whenever and however those in power tell them to, while accepting no personal responsibility for their actions. I hope you are better than that. Keep in mind, there are a lot of decent Americans who do have the integrity and courage to draw a line in the sand, a point at which they will disobey and resist violations of their rights by those in power. It may be that they refuse to be disarmed. It may be that they refuse to cooperate with warrantless searches, or refuse to keep funding a government they view as destructive and unjust. Whether you agree with them doesn't particularly matter. What does matter is whether, in the end, you are willing, if and when you are ordered to do so, to violently assault the dissenters for their disobedience. When they draw their line in the sand and stand their ground, and your supervisors tell you to use whatever level of violence necessary to get submission and compliance from the resistors, will you obey? If it came down to it, would you kill American citizens for disobeying politicians? Now, if someone is actually harming someone else, of course you have the right to use whatever force necessary to stop the attacker and protect the innocent. But that would be the case even if you had no badge and no uniform. But when you try to arrest someone who hasn't threatened or harmed anyone else, but has only disobeyed some arbitrary regulation, then you are the one initiating force. You are the one starting a fight. You are the bad guy. Now remember, the American Revolution was people forcibly resisting gun confiscation, warrantless searches, what they viewed as unfair taxation, and a number of other oppressions. All in the name of law, all carried out by law enforcers. If you had lived back then, would you have been among the rebel colonists, the ones who refused to be disarmed, refused to pay taxes, and resisted warrantless detainment and searches? Would you have sided with the signers of the Declaration of Independence, or would you have been among the redcoats, the law enforcers, assaulting, caging, or killing any colonists with the gall to disobey the king? And which side are you on today? Of course, the message you'll get from your superiors, the politicians, and your fellow officers is that it's not your place to decide which laws to enforce, and that as long as you faithfully follow orders, that you can't be held personally responsible for doing as you're told. But that is a lie, a horribly dangerous lie. At the Nuremberg trials, it was established that the excuse used by the Nazi law enforcers that they weren't to blame and shouldn't be punished because they were just doing as they were told did not relieve them of personal responsibility for their actions. And make no mistake, if you choose to blindly obey unjust commands, and one day your intended victims decide to fight back, saying that you're just doing your job will not make you bulletproof. It may be your own life you save by deciding now at what point you will choose to be a moral, responsible human being instead of just an obedient pawn of those in power. Ultimately, only you can answer the question of where you will draw that line. But really, the only moral, rational answer is this. If something would be wrong for you to do without a badge, then you shouldn't do it with one either. The idea that uniforms and legislation can give you special rights is both false and horribly dangerous. Nearly every large-scale injustice in history was committed by people who wrongly imagined that their position of authority made it okay for them to do things that other people have no right to do. Like everyone else, you have the right to use force to stop attackers and protect the innocent, and when you do that, you are the hero. But you have no right to be the attacker, even if it's your job, and even if the aggression is called law. Always, in every situation, you and you alone are responsible for what you do. Wearing a badge and a uniform and doing whatever you're told does not make you brave and noble or deserving of any respect. Just following orders is a coward's excuse. If your job requires you to assault or cage people who haven't threatened or harmed anyone, then quit. Being an actual protector, doing the right thing no matter what anyone else says, even if it means disobeying orders and breaking the law, that takes courage and integrity. That makes you a hero. So, do you have enough of a spine to draw that line? Decide now, before your failure to think for yourself results in damage that cannot be undone. To whom does your life belong? Who owns you? Most people instinctively answer, "I own myself." But most people don't actually believe that. What does it mean to own something? It means that you and you alone have the right to decide what is done with that thing. What is yours you can use, you can trade, you can give away, you can destroy. So what does it mean to say you own yourself? It means that you and you alone have the right to decide what is done with your body and your mind, with your time and your energy. If someone else had the right to decide what is done with your body and your mind, your time and your energy, then he would be your owner and you would be his slave. So, are you anyone's slave? Do you pay taxes? Do you feel obligated to obey whatever the politicians decide to call law? Do you imagine that someone else has the right to control you, to rule you? Do you vote? In every political election, you are asked to decide who you want owning you, but owning yourself is never one of the options offered. The only choice you are given is the choice of which politicians will coerce and control you by way of so-called regulation and legislation, and confiscate what you produce by way of taxation. Whoever wins, you will be extorted and dominated. When you vote, whether you win or not, you are accepting that someone else has the right to rule you. You are conceding the state's authority over you. You are agreeing that you are going to be someone's slave, with the only question being which political master will own you. If you believe that you have an obligation to pay taxes, if you concede that it is up to someone else to decide how much of your earnings they will let you keep, then you are their slave. If you own yourself, you don't need the permission of anyone, any individual, any group, any collective, any country, any legislature, to run your own life, make your own choices, and keep the fruits of your own labor. As long as the politicians see you voting, petitioning, protesting, and campaigning, begging for tax cuts, whining for different legislation, as long as they see you timidly obeying whatever commands they issue while begging them to change their so-called laws, then they know that they own you in mind and body. Writing or calling your congressman merely tells him that you still think he's important, that you still view him and his fellow parasites as authority, and that you still think it's his choice whether to let you be free or not. As long as you play their games and legitimize their system, obeying their so-called laws and paying their so-called taxes, acting as if they are your rightful lords and masters, the tyrants know they have nothing to fear. The slave master doesn't mind his slaves pitifully begging for mercy, as long as they keep obeying and keep producing wealth for the master to steal. Those in power aren't worried about elections or petitions. What they do fear is that one day their victims will realize the truth, will stop believing in the divine right of politicians, will stop calling liars and crooks lawmakers, will stop calling the tyrants, mercenaries, law enforcers, will stop believing that anyone has the right to rule them, will stop imagining authority where there is none, will realize that they own themselves, and will stop bowing to the parasitical, anti-human beast called government. If you own your time and effort, and the fruits of your labor, then stop asking nicely to be allowed to keep it. If you own yourself, then stop asking nicely for legislative permission to run your own life. If you actually believe in unalienable rights, in individual liberty, in freedom, then stop asking nicely for the sociopathic parasites to let you be free. For humanity to be free, people need to stop thinking, talking, and acting like slaves. Stop bowing to megalomaniacs. Stop paying tribute to sociopaths. Stop obeying political parasites. If you truly understand that you own yourself, then start acting like it.
And with me now, Milwaukee County Sheriff David Clark. Sheriff Clark, what do you say? I mean, what's your reaction to this? Is it open season on law enforcement in this country?
Judge, I am too pissed off tonight to be diplomatic about what's going on, and I'm not going to stick my head in the sand about it. I said last December that war had been declared on the American police officer led by some high-profile people, one of them coming out of the White House, one coming out of the United States.
Which is bullshit. War has been declared on the people, and that was done a long time ago by the police, by the government. So this bullshit about war on the police, when I was mentioning something like She's, it's around like 60 a year or something average. I don't know the exact number for last year. It's a very small number that actually are killed by other people, police homicides. Now, they want to take the number and count like police that die on the job in a car accident or something like that. But if you take the number of police that are killed by homicides, even with those couple shootings that had happened in Dallas and New Orleans, it's not going to change the number all that much. I think in total it was eight officers or something like that. So, and then what they do though is they can say, oh, the number went up 50% or something. I mean, because the number is so small anyway, they're able to say, like, they'll use percentage. Because if they use the actual number, people will be like, well, that's not really that many compared to the amount of officers in the country. So they don't want to put things in perspective. They want to act like, oh, police, there's a war on the police and, you know, people are targeting police. You know, one or two people in the whole fucking country targeting police, or even if you want to say 10, and it's not that many, but is nothing compared to the amount of police. And looking at, you know, the United States is the third biggest country in the world. Now, it won't be for long, looking at projections of population in other countries, but it still is at like 320 million something. So putting it in perspective, there's a lot more people that are killed by police than police that are killed by people. And it's always this, you know, we want to make sure we're safe, meaning the police. What about the people being safe? The police have their hands on their guns, but, you know, they'll grab yours right away. You know, put your hands up. Let me see your hand. Make sure that you don't have access to a gun. What about defending yourself? What if the cop starts fucking shooting at you? No, that's okay. But you can't have your gun on you. It's just, I don't know. To me, it's ridiculous. What makes the, and I'm talking about in like traffic stops or whatever. And if you're too fucking scared, then don't stop somebody or don't be a fucking cop.
Department of Justice. And it's open season right now. There's no doubt about it. Look, anytime a law enforcement officer is killed, a little of every police officer in America dies along with them.
And Sheriff, you know, as law enforcement across the country watches this, and I
should every time a person's killed by a cop, should a little bit of them die too? Because there's a lot of them compared to the small amount of police that are killed.
Ask the sheriff, Sheriff Hickman in Harris County, you know, in New York and in certain.
And this guy's a fucking piece of shit anyway. David Clark, he fucking puts himself all over the news because he wants to run for office or be part of Obama's fucking some advisor or some shit. But I mean, I think that's what he's trying to do, is set up for some kind of career in, you know, beyond sheriff.
Baltimore and in Ferguson, you know, no peace, no justice, no justice, no peace, and all the crazy marches and all the, you know, some of these organizations out there. Apparently in Harris County, this isn't something that was normal. I mean, can this happen anywhere in the country now?
Anywhere in the United States, and I'm tired of hearing people call these black activists. They're not activists. This is black slime, and it needs to be eradicated from the American society.
But how
and American
do you do
culture.
It? How do you do it, Sheriff?
Well, here's how you do it. I need every law-abiding person in the United States of America to stand up and start pushing back against this slime, this filth, this disparaging the American law enforcement officer within these communities. When these ugly people come out and start this and start.
See, this is what the police want. They want to be able to do whatever they want and not be criticized for it. And this goes back, well, at least me reading about it, you know, goes back a few years, looking at their websites and the things that they were putting on there, and they don't want to be criticized. They're like little fucking babies. The type of people that they hire are, you know, little sensitive, little fucking bitches.
They're talking this stuff on social media to push back against it and demand people that belong to these organizations to get out of their town. There's no room for it. Look, the American police officer is holding these communities together, and we need the support of the people that we defend every day in order to get that done. God bless the Harris County Sheriff's Office. Kudos to that district attorney for acknowledging the war on police. But I'm tired of qualifying all these statements by talking about bad apples within the policing profession.
All right. Sheriff, I want you to take a listen to what Ron Hickman, the Harris County Sheriff, said.
We've heard Black Lives Matter, all lives matter. Well, cops' lives matter too. So why don't we just drop the qualifier and just say lives matter and take that to the bank?
Interesting reaction.
We need to hear more of that from everybody. I know there's been some pushback on that, and that's good. This whole movement, Black Lies, I've renamed it L-I-E-S, because it's based on a lie, the hands up, don't shoot. That's why I said this slime needs to be eradicated from American society and American culture.
And with someone like this defendant, and this is, he's charged with murder, and it is death eligible, capital murder, the killing of a police officer. You know, we saw in New York City with Ramos and Wenjian Liu, two cops sitting in a police car, I think it was Christmas Eve, just get executed. You know, someone in New York City comes after a cop with a machete in his hands. And this is happening all over the country. I mean, what impact does this have on law enforcement? I mean, do they back off or do they just keep doing their job? Or are they like, you know what, I don't need this. We got six cops indicted in Baltimore. Why would someone even be a cop these days?
Well, we better hope that that doesn't happen for the sake of the rule of law, the sake of our way of life here in the United States. This was an assault on the American way of life, the American justice system. And if the American police officer backs off, we're all in trouble. Look, we live in a state of hypervigilance. And now we're going to have to turn that up even more. But the American police officer is strong. We will continue to fight back. We will continue to sacrifice ourselves for the good law-abiding people in every community of the United States.
And finally, Sheriff, the national rhetoric that's going on, you say that people need to push back and we need to see things when we see things on Facebook or on social media. You know, the truth is that people can say and do whatever they want. This is America. But without leadership, you know, there isn't going to be any different, you know, reaction. More people seem to be emboldened by this kind of thing.
Right. And that's why I said that the President of the United States started this war on police. Look, and I know what you mean, Judge, by that, but it's not absolute. You can't say anything you want in the United States of America. You cannot threaten people's lives. You can't call for the killing of people like we're seeing from some of these things. That is not First Amendment protection. That is protected. That is filth. That is slime. And, you know, there are some law enforcement implications that can be done with the Department of Justice and with state attorneys' offices across the United States. I love the First Amendment. I love freedom of speech. You are not free to threaten my life or anybody else's.
All right. Sheriff David Clark, thanks so much for being with us tonight.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. That dude's a fucking douchebag. Anyway, you want to talk about rhetoric? I mean, that's basically what it is. They want to act like, yes, there are certain areas that are bad, but in general, as I was saying earlier, I mean, they're not arresting people for all of these things, all these violent crimes. I mean, that's not the majority of the people that they're going after. And I had mentioned the Las Vegas statistics. And, you know, going back to Cops, the show, not actual cops, but yes, they're actual cops in the show. I mean, the amount of people that are, one, they got to be the stupidest fucking people that they show, because as I was saying earlier, most of these people are just talking to the police officers, telling them all this shit. They're telling them even shit that, like, they're not even asking them. They're just volunteering information. Now, I think what they're trying to do with the show, part of it is make people think. And even when they ask the questions of people, they want people to think that they have to talk to the police, at least until they're arrested. But then they still ask questions. And the way they ask it, you know, even with searches, they'll say, it's all right if I search you, right? Or, you don't mind if I search you, right? I mean, so what do you say to that? What you should really do during a traffic stop is tell them right away that you are, you can kind of say it however you want. You could say, I don't answer questions, or I'm exercising my Fifth Amendment rights, or something like that. And then say, and I don't consent to any searches. And what they'll do is they'll keep fucking talking to you. Even people that say, you know, I don't want to answer anything else, they'll keep talking to them. They'll egg them on to talk. And there was even a former police officer who was on the Tom Woods show who was talking about how police are trained to do that. They're trained to get people to talk. So to start talking about whatever and to get them going on from there. And if you notice, you know, cops always ask you, well, where are you coming from and where are you going and stuff like that. And then they want to get more of an idea of more things. If you say, well, I just came from my friend's house, and then, you know, oh, where's your friend live? And then if you keep answering these questions, and they might think, oh, well, you came from a drug area, and now we want to search your car. And that's what happened with so many of these people. And a lot of them, you know, there were a lot that had warrants, but a lot of the warrants were for fucking traffic bullshit. But there were ones where if it wasn't for them talking, that they never would have had their car searched and found drugs in the first place. Now, as somebody who believes that you own yourself and the government doesn't own you, and that other people do not have the right to decide for you what you can and cannot put in your body, or to make decisions about your life, as long as they do not directly affect them. And when I say directly affect them, the directly is in big capital letters, because that would be, you know, directly affect them, like assault them or rob them or whatever, as I was mentioning earlier. So when a cop arrests you for drugs, as far as I'm concerned, they're violating your rights. When they search your car, they're violating your rights. All of these things are rights violations. What they'll do also is they'll have, if you refuse, because you don't have to let them search your car, and people will think that they do as well. And that's what they do in the show. Is I don't think I've seen more than one or two in maybe, you know, 20 or 30 episodes, people say that they don't give permission to search them or they don't give permission to search their car. And I'm sure there are people that are. They just don't show it on Cops because, again, Cops is a show that the editing, the final product, is controlled by Cops. Or they wouldn't, you know, let them film it in the first place. I don't believe that there's any type of law that says that if you go for a ride along that you're entitled to film. Because I know they do ride alongs, and I don't know even with ride alongs that they're required by law. I seriously doubt it. They might just do that as a, you know, courtesy or something, if you want to call it that. But, I mean, it's a show. So right away, I mean, they have to give permission to show their likeness and stuff like that. And I'm sure that there's something in the contract that says, you know, if they want something taken out, it's going to be taken out. And if they didn't do that, you know, how many cops are actually, or departments are going to be cooperative and let them do the show? They're going to say, no, you fucked over this department, I heard, and put stuff on the air that they didn't want put on the air. So, no, we're not going to be on the show. And I found a number of, there was actually even a show, and I don't know if it was affiliated with Cops or it was just a local show, but they had a Las Vegas Cops on YouTube. There are only a certain amount of episodes, but even on the regular Cops, they have, you know, occasionally they're in Las Vegas. As I mentioned, they walked up to people and just open their doors. I mean, there's so many rights violations. I mean, there's the rights violations that I look at as you're violating their rights, even though the law says it's okay. And then there's actual even violating the law. And these cops don't have to, I mean, they have discretion. They don't have to arrest people for drugs. If every cop in the country said, we're not arresting people for drugs anymore, or even in a state, if all the sheriffs got together and said, look, our policy is that we're not arresting people for drugs. I don't give a fuck how much it is. So we're not fucking searching cars anymore. As long as they're registered and the person has a license, you know, give them a ticket for if there's a traffic violation. But in going back to, you know, as I mentioned, the guy, former, I think, sheriff or at least law enforcement officer that talked about being trained to get people to talk, you know, he said the reason for that, for pulling people over even for something like a taillight out or some traffic violation, was to get not only them talking, but get them talking so you can search the car. Develop reasonable suspicion, because I think that's all you need to search the car. You might need probable cause. But whichever level you need, get that from conversations with them. You know, you have officers looking at, oh, the guy was shaking and whatever. And I was shaking before when I was younger when I got pulled over. And I had nothing illegal on me. Just because fucking cops will arrest you when you didn't even do anything. And I have got arrested for things that aren't crimes. And as I said, it got, you know, the DA didn't file charges. So this whole thing, like, well, if you didn't do anything wrong, it's just like the concept of, well, if you're not doing anything wrong, you shouldn't care if the government is recording all your fucking phone calls and, you know, wiretapping you and all of these things, of course you should care. I mean, it's bullshit. You don't know what they're going to make illegal, how they're going to use it against you. And there's just so many levels of things that they can do with that information, even in controlling things that go on within the country, just like Google with their search information, how much that alone, and that's just search information, you know. And it's funny, I noticed this number come up, and I think it's like selling things or something like that or whatever, but it came up on two phones, and within a short period of time. And I'm thinking that what they're even doing somehow, and they had those Google cars that were actually stealing information, and Google got fined for it. They were taking information off the via your wireless and off your computer, the fucking Google cars that were driving around, that they're taking phone information or your phone number somehow in the area and calling those phones. And that's just another, it's just another fucking thing. And then you try to call them back and you get a busy signal. But I looked, you can type in to one of the search engines and look up some of these numbers, and people were like, yeah, I got a call from it, and it was some fucking selling whatever. But there's a couple numbers that do that. And I think my fiance had it on her phone too. And it's like they're going through like picking up numbers or sucking up numbers. And that's not even, you know, I don't think that's necessarily law enforcement. I think it's, you know, these marketing companies, but this is the same thing. It's bad enough what a company like Google can do with all this information. And then you have the government that's taking even more information and all of the things that they can do with it. So, and people just, that's something too, that law enforcement has illegally used these, there's a name for them, I can't think of it right now, but where your cell phone will bounce off that fake tower so they can listen in. And they do it illegally. They don't have warrants. Not that warrants mean anything. Warrants are like, you know, it's just a sign off from a judge. It's fucking meaningless at this point. Warrants are just, you know, to say, oh yeah, we got permission from a judge, but it's a rubber stamp. It is with, you know, the FISA court, where they were getting supposed warrants to tap specific people, terrorists and stuff like that, which they're collecting all the information anyway. It's just, it's all fucked up. And, you know, it goes back to the same thing. It's just people either don't want to say anything, they just want to, you know, believe in this illusion of freedom and have people rule over them, have the fucking, their dogs, meaning the police, you know, be able to do whatever they want and violate their rights if they feel like it and have to bow down to them. And we'll be doing a part two of this on Thursday. Tomorrow, we'll be joined by Ken Shorgen. Haven't had Ken on in a while since I haven't been on the air in a while. So he'll be joining us to talk about geopolitics and the economy as usual. So we'll see what's going on there. But that's all the time we have left for the show. But again, we'll be back to talk about the same subject on Thursday. We'll be back tomorrow, but we'll be back again on Thursday for part two of Cops, and I'll talk more about the show and more about cops in general. So be sure to tune in tomorrow for Ken and the geopolitics and the economy, and again on Thursday for more cop talk. All right. Thanks, everybody. Have a good night.
Listen to police officers' commands. Listen to what we tell you and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take it. You're forced. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.